The COVID-19 pandemic has had a telling effect on global economies. Governments recorded dramatic drops in projected growth. Millions lost their jobs, and the most vulnerable lost their lives. The Caribbean has been hard hit as governments closed borders, mobilized health services, and urged their publics to undertake new ways of living and working for their health's sake. The private sector has been hardest hit, particularly small to medium enterprises, with bankruptcies, closures, and a drastic reduction in activities. The number of the unemployed is swollen, forcing governments to top up those who lost wages and to shore up businesses. The IMF, World Bank, IDB, and the Caribbean Development Bank have all provided financing. As the region reopens to international travel and welcomes tourists, restoration of economies to pre-COVID times is top of mind. We launched the 2020 series of the Caribbean Economic Forum, produced by the Central Bank of Barbados, with the topic COVID and economic policy, protecting jobs, businesses, and the economy. Our host is Cleviston Haynes, the governor of the Central Bank of Barbados in Bridgetown. The current chairman of the Central Bankers of the Caribbean is Dr. Gobind Ganga of the Bank of Guyana in Georgetown. The central banker overseeing the monetary interests of 8 countries is Timothy Antoine, the governor of the Eastern Caribbean Central Bank in Bastyr St. Kitts. And our fourth central banker is Richard Byles, governor of the Bank of Jamaica in Kingston. Our discussion is intended to give our Caribbean audience an appreciation of the role of the central banks in this economic recovery. It is an opportunity to interact with the governors through the many channels we will share. I'm Julian Rogers in Kingston, welcoming all to the 2020 series of the Caribbean Economic Forum.
And a very good evening, wherever you are across this Caribbean or beyond the Caribbean, following this first edition of what we call the virtual edition of the Caribbean Economic Forum. Yes, I'm in Kingston, Jamaica, and the panel this evening, sitting in Bastyr St. Kitts, in Bridgetown, Barbados, in Georgetown, Guyana, and of course, Governor Richard Byles is in Kingston, where I am as well. So a special welcome to all of you. And I'm gonna start first by engaging with the governor of the OECS, the Eastern Caribbean Currency Union, so to speak, Timothy. And I think it's important to give all of you actually an opportunity to give our audience a sense of where our countries were when we realized the first impact of COVID. So, Timothy Antoine in Bastyr, I want you first to respond to that question. Where were your states at that point, say in March?
So thank you very much, Julian. Let me say good evening to all of our viewers and listeners in the Caribbean and around the world. I do wish to also thank Governor Haynes and his team at the Central Bank of Barbados for arranging this regional conversation. To your question, where was the ECCU at the outset or prior to the outset or onset of the pandemic? Well, the ECCU was actually projecting to grow by 3.5% before the pandemic. Since then, and up now, our latest projection is that we will contract, the ECCU will contract by between 10 and 20% this year alone. So you can see the dramatic change in the economic fortunes of our currency union as a result of the pandemic. But of course, Julian, you would appreciate that this impact is not unique to the ECCU. In fact, the world is facing its worst economic crisis in almost 100 years. We're told that the global economy this year will contract by at least 5% based on the IMF estimates as of yesterday. And we know the impact has been great on large and small economies. The US is going to contract by 8%, the UK by 10%. Africa, for the first time in 25 years, will actually contract. And of course, all countries in the CARICOM area, with the exception of Guyana, will contract this year. We're all in recession. So that is the starting point. That is where we are at the moment.
All right, I'll ask the same question of, as you talk about Guyana, let's go to the Governor Ganga in Georgetown. I have to say that many of us looked on with certain envy over the recent years to the kind of growth that Guyana was enjoying, and then the prospect of oil and so on really boosting that further. But COVID came along, and hit you as well. So tell us, what happened then back in March?
Indeed, Julian. As you know, our economic fundamentals were very, very favorable prior to COVID. Our growth rate with oil was about 87% projected. Non-oil growth would have been just over 5% or about there. Our inflation rate would have been very, very low single digit. We would have had an increase in reserves as we were projecting. Our exchange rate would have remained, and we expect that to remain, relatively stable. However, after COVID, or with the impact of COVID, obviously with respect to global demand declining from growth, we would have seen a significant decline in economic activities. With oil, after COVID, we would have projected 57% growth in GDP, which would have been a significant decline from where we were projecting to be prior to COVID. In non-oil growth, we are now looking at negative 5 to 7%. It could even be more if this is prolonged, because major sectors would have been hit, such as the services sector, transport, communication, education, administration, likewise wholesale and retail. Like manufacturing would have also been affected. So would have been agriculture, some subsectors. So what we would have seen would have been coming out from a very glorious outlook, where we were the star of the region and even in the world, to one where we are now just like any ordinary country being impacted by this pandemic. So Julian, having said that, it doesn't necessarily mean that everything is gone. We are still looking forward for some stability and growth and development as we move forward.
Well, I have to take issue with you, because when you say that Guyana was the star, I think you give me a good lead in here for Jamaica, because certainly last year there were the stars in terms of boasting about getting through a very stringent, homegrown, so to speak, IMF program. And then Governor Byles, who was not even in the chair for a year as yet, had to contend not only with a new job, but a whole new perspective. So Governor Byles, by March, you didn't expect anything like this. None of us expected that. So where was Jamaica at that point?
Yes, we, for the last 7 years, we had been on a track of a very strong economic reform program. And we had made good headway. Our debt to GDP had been reduced from 145 to 92. We had built our reserves from just a little under $1 billion to over $3.6 billion. We had got unemployment down to about 7.2%. And we had made major reforms in the financial sector. And the banks were strong and doing very well, good capitalization. So it was, COVID came and interrupted that process and has set us back. But we feel that if we pick up from where we left off, we will be able to achieve, maybe a little later than we had hoped, but we will achieve exactly what we wanted, which is macro-financial stability, low inflation, and economic growth. We had projected growth of about 1.1% before COVID, and that has now been reversed. We expect about -4% to -7%, somewhere in there, hopefully closer to the -4% than the -7%. So we remain hopeful. We have begun the process of reopening the economy, and so let's see what we can do.
All right, well, let's see. We will talk a lot more about that, about the kinds of measures that you've implemented. Well, let me go to Barbados and to our host, the governor of the central bank there, Cleviston Haynes. Certainly, again, I must remark that many of us looked at the Barbados situation over recent years and said, what happened to Barbados? And if that happened to Barbados, hey, woe betide us, so to speak. But you were in the chair for quite some time. You've been there for, I don't know, 30 years at the central bank. So you've seen all the changes over time, but not a change like this. So where was Barbados then?
Thank you, Julian. Like my colleagues, we were significantly impacted by this COVID crisis. As everyone knows, Barbados went through a period of sort of economic paralysis where our reserves were falling. There was sluggish economic activity and our debt was beginning to explode. And so over the last 2 years, we worked very diligently to restore the situation to the point where our reserves have been rebuilt to comfortable levels. We've had some debt restructuring, which has brought our debt levels down. And the only thing that we really wanted to do now was to get the economy to grow. We anticipated for 2020 that we'd be able to get some modest growth backed by investment from foreign investors. But when COVID came, that basically threw all of our plans askew. Over the past year, we were able to get a primary surplus on our fiscal of 6% of GDP, and we've had to cut that back to an estimate right now of 1% of GDP, and being able to achieve that 1% will really depend on how strongly we're able to maintain economic activity going forward. So rather than getting modest economic growth, we now expect to have a double-digit fall in output for 2020. And as you've seen, as everybody has seen, that has resulted in significant loss in jobs, loss in revenue for government. And one thing that really has stood out for us is that our reserves held steady. Not only have we been able to get resources from the IMF, but we've not really had to sell foreign exchange in order to shore up our reserves over the past 3 months. And that, I think, is a positive sign in terms of the developments that we've had.
All right, so there's a framework. There's the so-called canvas upon which we will work this evening. And I will go back to Timothy in Bastiers and Kitts and talk about the work of the ECCU. You've got so many territories to look after the interest. You succeeded over several decades now to maintain a par rate to the US dollar of 270, et cetera. Where's the pressure and what are the measures that you've had to implement so far to keep some kind of stability in the market?
So just to be clear, Julian and viewers, the Eastern Caribbean Central Bank, one of our principal tasks is to maintain a strong EC dollar. And we do that by maintaining strong foreign reserves to back the EC dollar. So the law says the backing must be at least 60%. With foreign reserves. At the moment, we're almost at 100%. And so we've come into the pandemic in a strong position in respect of our foreign reserves. Import cover, foreign reserves, and generally, we believe that we are in a good position to weather this difficult season. So far, the currency continues to perform very well. There's very little change, frankly, between the start of the pandemic and now. But you ask, what have we been doing? So specifically, at the outset of the pandemic, the central bank provided a grant of $4 million to our member countries, half a million each, to assist them with critical supplies, equipment and supplies. Because the first rule in fighting a pandemic, the first rule in pandemic economics is to control the pandemic. And truth be told, as a region, we have controlled this pandemic, at least at this up to this point. Yes, a great sacrifice, to be clear, but we have controlled the pandemic. So that in several countries, including at least half of the ECCU, there are now no active cases of COVID-19. In addition to that, the central bank, our central bank, has worked with the commercial banks to support a loan deferral program of up to 6 months. The credit unions are doing a similar thing, I think, for about 3 months. We've lowered the discount rate, which is a rate at which we lend to banks and governments, to 2%. Before that, it was 6.5%. And for the first time in 17 years, we lowered that rate, the discount rate. And so at this moment, we stand ready as a central bank to provide liquidity to our commercial banks as needed. At this stage, they have not requested that support, principally because they have entered the pandemic well capitalized. But of course, we anticipate that this will be a long, difficult season. And so we stand ready to provide liquidity support as needed. There are other measures, but this is a sample of some of the things that we've done so far.
All right. Let me ask the same question of Dr. Ganga in Georgetown, Guyana. What have you put in place so far?
Thanks, Julian. The number of fiscal monetary policies that we would have been implemented to combat the adverse impacts of COVID-19. On the fiscal front, we would have had removal of VAT on utility. We would have also removed VAT on domestic air travel. We would have been paying pension earlier. We would have also been removing excise duties on sanitized products. So essentially what was happening was that we were trying to provide more disposable income to everyone to ensure that there is a basic, I would say, indirect transfer. So one would be able to do the necessary adjustment for welfare improvement. With respect to firms, as I said, there were also some deferral and there were some removal of excise on a temporary basis. They also had deferral in terms of tax payment. On the monetary perspective, and as you know, if you don't have an enabled environment in the financial system, you're not going to continue with growth and development, because that will also be putting additional pressure on fiscal government fiscal stance. Essentially, what we would have done would have also provided a moratorium of 6 months for credit facility in terms of repayment of loans, especially for those firms and even individuals who would have been affected by COVID. In addition to that, we continue with respect to a very, very accommodative monetary policy to ensure that there is enough liquidity in the system so that whoever would want to borrow would be able to borrow. But at the same time, we ensure that inflation is being checked. I could tell you now that our inflation rate is below 1%. So there is sufficient room for us to continue our monetary policy. Our exchange rate remained relatively stable. We would have projected an increase in reserves. However, because of the impact on both oil and non-oil prices for some of our commodities, we weren't able to do that significantly, but we would have that room as we go ahead. But the bottom line is that what we would have provided from the central bank side would have been that confidence in our economy from the financial perspective, in that we have a sound banking system, we have a situation where the economic fundamentals remain very favorable for growth and development, so that we can encourage investors to come in, households can also have this confidence going forward that their real disposable income remain intact. Thanks, Julian.
Thank you very much, sir. Before I ask the next governor to respond to this similar question, I just want to remind you that this is the Caribbean Economic Forum. It's coming across the entire Caribbean on television and online and beyond the Caribbean for that matter. I'm Julian Rogers in Kingston, Jamaica. Timothy and Antoine is in Bastia's and Kitts at the Eastern Caribbean Currency Union headquarters there. We've also got Dr. Ganga in Georgetown, Guyana. He is at the Bank of Guyana. Richard Byles is at the Bank of Jamaica. And Cleviston Haynes, who is our host, governor this evening, he's in Bridgetown, Barbados. Let me go to Kingston, or stay in Kingston for that matter, where I am, and talk to Governor Byles about the measures which the central bank has put in place in response to the COVID situation.
Thank you, Julia. On March 21st, when we had to close our borders, it had a ripple effect in financial markets. Stock exchange started a fall that eventually ended up at about 30% of its value. And the bond market also went into a fall. And so many mutual funds found themselves and corporations with securities on their books that were valued a whole lot less and quite illiquid. So the Bank of Jamaica had to step in and provide both Jamaican dollar liquidity as well as US dollar liquidity. On the Jamaican dollar side, we lowered our cash reserves by 2%, right down to the statutory minimum of 5%. And we embarked on a bond buying program where we bought back bonds Jamaican dollar, Jamaican government bonds, as well as Bank of Jamaica bonds from the financial sector, not just the banks, but from the security dealers too. That put approximately, let's call it $350 million US, the equivalent of liquidity into the system. And today I can say that Jamaican dollar liquidity in the financial sector is very stable and very sufficient, and we don't have any concerns about that. On the US dollar side, the closure of our borders meant that approximately $2 billion US dollars a year was cut off from the economy. Now, that's a very big number. And so the foreign exchange market reacted to it rationally. And we had to step in, and we had to use different methods in order to keep the market rational. We reduced the cash reserves on US dollar deposits also by 2%, and that put a lot of liquidity into the market. We entered into swaps with the commercial banks, where we provided US dollars, they provided J dollars to us, and then we would swap it back later on. We entered into a program of repurchase of US dollar bonds that they held, bonds issued by Jamaican government or Bank of Jamaica. And also we sold foreign currency into the market. Of course, we also, in conjunction with the IMF, accessed the RFI for $520 million also. So all in all, we put ourselves in a position where there was more than sufficient liquidity in the foreign exchange market. Over the period, I think we probably have provided about $400 million US dollars of liquidity in the market. And those are the major steps that the central bank had to take to make sure that Jamaican dollar and US liquidity was at sufficient levels.
Governor Haynes, you referred earlier to the protection of the Barbados dollar, etc. I give you a chance now to spell out some of the critical measures that you put in place in response to COVID.
Right, so In terms of the dollar in Barbados, obviously the big buffer for that is our international reserves. And as I pointed out earlier, we were going through a period of rebuilding our reserves. And since the onset of COVID, we've been able to get resources both from the IDB and excess resources from the IMF, which has taken our reserves close to 2 billion Barbados dollars, which is sort of unprecedented in terms of the level of reserves that we have. So we feel very comfortable with the stock of reserves, and the support that we have done in terms of monetary policy is a lot similar to what Governor Antoine mentioned in the context of the OECS, in the sense that we went into this with a situation where the interest rate environment was quite low and the banks were flush with liquidity. And what we did was basically lower the discount rate from 7% to 2%. We reduced our securities ratio for banks. We eliminated it for our smaller Part 3 entities to ensure that if they had any liquidity challenges, that they would be able to get access to that liquidity. Today, none of them has had to come to us for liquidity support because, as I said, the liquidity in the system is quite high. We complemented that with our discussions with commercial banks, such that they provided moratoria to the private sector for their loans, because we recognize that both individuals and corporates will be affected by the loss of economic activity and the loss of jobs. And that has gone relatively smoothly so far. And then, of course, we've supported the government in terms of restructuring how we approach the overall macroeconomic policy. As I mentioned earlier, we reduced the primary balance from 6% to 1% as our target for this year. And what the government has been doing is, on the one hand, increasing its expenditure on health in order to address the challenges of the pandemic, but also trying to provide support as a social safety net to the private sector, both in terms of individuals, the unemployment insurance, severance, welfare payments, as well as making available to the private sector a VAT loan fund provide cash flow in these difficult times. And of course, we also encourage the banks to provide working capital to the corporates who may need it to help them get through what is clearly a very difficult challenge for us.
Gentlemen, I want to spend the next 5 minutes very quickly. I'll go around the table, so to speak. It's now 3 months, we're down to the end of June now. Is it too early to talk about the impact of the measures you've taken in place? Can I go around and ask for a sounding here? Let me start in Bastos and Kitts. Has it changed the mood? Have people responded positively from the business sector? I know that you're a technical expert, but at the same time, I know that you must feel the atmosphere on the ground.
So you would appreciate that most of our economies, not just in the ECCU, but around the Caribbean, are tourism-dependent economies. And so to a large extent, the recovery of the regional economy, the recovery of the ECCU, is tied to the recovery of tourism. At this moment, tourism is shut. So the impact that we're seeing in terms of jobs, the impact that we see in terms of revenues in several of our governments, countries, our revenues have plummeted to less than 50%, or at least they've fallen by 50% of what they were pre-COVID. Those impacts are real and continuing. And until and unless tourism reopens, those impacts will continue. And so because our borders are still closed, most countries, and because tourism is likely to have a protracted recovery, we are still at the very early stages, in my estimation, of this situation. And so we are now internally in our countries relaxing, reopening local businesses and so on. So that helps. So in that sense, economic activity has picked up in the last month. But in terms of the macroeconomy, nothing fundamentally or dramatically will change until we're able to get tourism resuscitated or recovered. And that is really the major challenge, I think, that we all face at this time. And that is why there is this significant discussion going on about what are the protocols around which we will reopen our economies to tourism, reopen our borders for tourism. That's where we are in the ECCU at this time.
All right. So you focus on tourism as the savior, so to speak. And that, I think, is at the heart of the recovery effort here in Jamaica. So let me give Richard Byles an opportunity to set the stage for us.
Yes, well, I think what Timothy said is true of Jamaica, perhaps to a lesser extent than it is true for the Eastern Caribbean, because we are not as tourism dependent, but nonetheless, it is a very major contributor to our foreign exchange earnings and to our employment. So it's true of us also. We opened our borders just recently, and we are hopeful that we can manage the process of restarting tourism. Some hotels are open and others are scheduled and have announced that they will open next month. Of course, a lot depends on the countries from which tourists are coming, that in those countries, the infection rate remains low or gets low and stays low, and that the protocol of involved in tourists coming back home is sufficiently simple that it doesn't stop people from wanting to take a vacation outside of the borders of their country. So to a large extent, our recovery is intertwined with the good management of the spread of the pandemic in countries like the United States, Canada, United Kingdom, and Europe in general.
All right, so I think that's an excellent opportunity for us to take a break here. Let me remind you, this is the Caribbean Economic Forum, and it's sponsored by the Central Bank of Barbados. And we have with us in a historic gathering four governors of the region, Timothy Antoine of the ECCU, which of course is the grouping with the Organization of Eastern Caribbean States. We have our Barbados Governor, Cleviston Haynes. In Guyana, there's Dr. Gobind Ganga, who is the governor of the Bank of Guyana, and also Richard Byles, who you just heard from. We'll take a break, but we'll come back with the reaction from our audience who have been following us on social media.
Hi, my name is Shay Annika Mears, and I came to the Central Bank as an intern in 2018. After my internship, I was asked to continue my duties no longer as an intern, but now as a clerical officer. However, majority of my time has been spent at the Frank Colma Hall, commonly referred to as FCH, which is Barbados's premier performing arts center. During my time working at the FCH, I've had the opportunity of working alongside well-known and new and upcoming artists. I've also had the pleasure of working in the fields such as stage management, events management, lighting, sound, and overall general maintenance of the facility. Some of the most notable shows that I would have worked would be Mosaic, Operation Triple Threat, Youth Pan Project, NIFCA, and most notable, City Nights, which was first held in 1986 in celebration of the opening of the FCH and the new headquarters of the Central Bank of Barbados. Needless to say, the bank plays a pivotal role not only in the financial and economic governance of the island. There's a lot of behind the scenes work that takes place that unfortunately the public doesn't get to see. I can only hope that through our team's work, we get to share more about the numerous activities in which the organization is involved and showcase how it contributes to Barbados, both with its economic work and its support for the arts.
www.centralbank.org.bb for more information.
Welcome back to the Caribbean Economic Forum. Of course, that sweet jingle CEF is something that you should bear in mind, because this series will continue until the end of the year, and every month we will have another focus on another set of guests. So the next one is reviving the tourism sector, which was, of course, was at the heart of our discussion before we went to the break. As usual, we've got an audience, and that audience is online, and therefore we want to turn our attention to them. We've got a moderator who has been looking and tracking that online activity, and he is Elihu Wahid. He's in Bridgetown, Barbados. Good evening, welcome, my friend.
Good night, Julian. Good night to the governors as well. And good night to the audience all across the Caribbean region. Tonight is historic in the fact that it gives ordinary people like myself the opportunity to interact with the governors on their perspectives and their plans on limiting the effect of COVID-19 economy. There are a couple themes which are coming through on social media. And so this first question would go to Gobind Ganga as the incoming chairman of the regional grouping of central bank governors. One question is, how can we work more closely together in the region to help limit the impact of COVID-19?
You heard the question, Governor?
Yes, I do. I just want to give thanks to the person who asked that question. And I just want to remind our audience that CARICOM is one of the oldest customs union in the world. Now, this custom union was set up largely because of the tremendous benefits that we can have by just having this custom union, this regional integration that was required so that we can all improve welfare. The bottom line is that a regional approach is very, very important because it provides for more efficient and effective way to address the challenges of COVID-19 or any of our problems or challenges that we may face. The bottom line is that, look, it doesn't only give us a larger voice, but it gives us this kind of situation where we are a single market and an economy, meaning there is no border. So in terms of all the externalities, positive externalities, we can all be able to enjoy those positive externalities. So we are not only going to improve national welfare, we are improving general welfare, that is of the region. So we improve our own welfare, we improve the regional welfare. So it's like double dipping into benefits from the regional integration that we have. So what we have to do is to deal with issue in a very coordinated, concerted, and a wholesome manner. And by doing that, we save a lot of energy and cost. Bottom line, as I said, is that CARICOM was set up to provide the kind of benefits in terms of a larger market, in terms of we are able not to go back and reinvent the wheel. We are able to allow for migration. We allow for our people to grow and develop. We allow for very decent, sustainable jobs for our people. All of this, as a matter of fact, I will tell you, almost all IFIs, they want to deal with the region, not individual countries, because they know the benefits that we can have by being a part of this CARICOM region. And therefore, as the incoming chair of CARICOM, we, as CARICOM governors, have been sharing international best practices that are relevant to us. We don't have to go back and reinvent the wheel. And we know that we have kind of brotherhood in the region, which we can all utilize for our own benefit and also for the region's benefit. Thank you, Julian.
Thank you very much, sir. I think well said. And we look forward, of course, to your tenure as the chairman of the Central Bankers of the Caribbean. Thank you very much, Elihu, as well, for posing a question on behalf of our online viewers and listeners. And let me assure you that you can continue to submit your questions, etc., and we'll certainly share them with the governors as we go along. This is the Caribbean Economic Forum, and let me return to the governors. And I was asking the question about measures and impact, etc. I didn't give an opportunity to Governor Haynes to comment on that, because I talked about the mood in these various countries as they see the various measures implemented, and we're now at the end of June. But before we do that, let me just go to the Hobart online and get an email question which is coming in, which I think is very important that we share right now. And given the significant reduction in government revenues forecasted, are you concerned about regional sovereign debt defaults or restructures? Who is going to be brave enough to bail that cat? Governor Haynes?
Well, Barbados has just gone through a debt restructuring of its own. 2018, the domestic one, and 2019, we completed the international one. So we know that when you get into very serious financial difficulty, that is an option which we don't like to utilize. Clearly, if you borrow money, you want to be able to honor your commitments to repay on a timely basis. And therefore, that restructuring, I think, is something that one should use only in very exceptional circumstances. And I think in our case, we thought that the circumstances warranted it. Clearly, from a regional perspective, all of the countries will face challenges because of the loss of revenue. And whether or not one adopts a strategy of restructuring debt will ultimately depend on the buffers which you have. Some countries have stronger buffers, as I pointed out earlier. In our own case, we've been able, because of the primary balances that we have incurred, the services that we've incurred over the past 2 years, we've been able to build up deposits, which enable us to continue to make payments for our public services. but some countries may face challenges. I can't really speak to how it will evolve in individual countries. Decisions will have to be made both in terms of servicing the debt or the delivery of the goods and services which you're able to provide. Because what this crisis has done is that it has caused us to refocus on the goods and services which we provide as governments. And depending on the nature of the revenue loss and depending on the type of services which are provided, then the decision will have to be made as to whether or not restructuring is a viable option in the respective territories.
I'll ask Ricky Byles to weigh in here because the matter of debt services is very critical. Yes, several of the countries you've been able to get support from the IMF and the World Bank, etc. But what are the concerns that you want to share with the Caribbean audience and particularly the Jamaican audience in regard to debt servicing?
Well, the question had to do with sovereign debt. So let's start there. Sovereign debt has to be serviced from foreign exchange reserves. In Jamaica, we have reserves, gross reserves of about $3.9 billion. So to the extent that the economic situation doesn't last for years and years, we certainly should have enough reserves to deal with all of our debt obligations. On the local debt side, I don't think there is an issue there. The government has built up a good buffer of cash reserves, and the tax has not fallen off to the extent that we feel endangered in any way, that we won't be able to pay debt. In fact, the tax numbers are turning out to be better than forecasted. So we feel pretty confident in that respect.
Governor Antoine, you have any anxieties at all?
Well, I think the primary and immediate need of our governments is liquidity, cash, to be able to manage their obligations to the citizens, provide basic services, and to take care of course, all the COVID-19 related expenditure. So here you have a situation where the revenues have plummeted, in some cases by as much as 50%. And at the same time, COVID-19 expenditures have grown exponentially. What our region, and certainly the ECCU, would wish is to see a debt standstill on the longer term debt. So I make a distinction between short-term debt, treasury bills, through, for example, the regional government securities market. We continue to operate that market in a normal way. We are rolling over, continuing to make issues, issuances, and in fact, up to earlier this week, I believe it was, or last week, we had an oversubscription on the regional government securities market. But we have said before the pandemic and again in this pandemic that we need a facility such that when there is a shock on our economies, as we have now, that there is a debt standstill. So what we would like for longer term debt is a debt standstill of 2 years to allow our countries time to recover before resuming debt servicing. We have fought for this because we believe that all small states should have what we call disaster-linked clauses, otherwise called hurricane clauses. They can be for any disaster, such that if you have a shock of a certain magnitude, there is a standstill that is agreed upfront between the issuer and the investor. So there is no issue of default. If a situation arises where there's a need, it triggers, the standstill triggers, and you know for a period of time, 1 year, 2 years, you do not service, and then you resume. That is the work we've been doing with the International Capital Markets Association, the IMF and the World Bank for the last several years, the Paris Club. And we have got them to agree to a term sheet. What we need now is the wide adoption of that term sheet. So we pioneered that idea in Grenada in 2014 and 15 in those debt clauses. I know Barbados did it recently in its restructuring. But we need to see that widespread for small states so that when there is an event, a hurricane, a pandemic, some kind of economic shock of a certain magnitude, not a rain here and a rain there, but large shocks, we can have the facility. Because what that does is to enable our countries to recover even faster. Because you can invest in your recovery and then you resume the debt servicing. So in sum, that is a continuing discussion. So for example, the Caribbean Development Bank has not given debt relief, but what it has done, it has provided a loan for member countries that need it to remain current with the CDB. So if you have a debt of, say, servicing of, say, 20 million, CDB will provide you with a loan of 20 million so you can stay current. Now, that adds to your debt, but it does provide cash flow relief. In the case of the IMF and the World Bank, they do not provide that sort of relief. So what has happened so far is that some of our countries, speaking for the ECCU, four of them have gone to the IMF, like Jamaica has done, and gotten rapid credit facilities to the tune of about $81 million to assist with financing. But I will end by saying we need to continue the conversation, because what is happening is that these shocks are happening so regularly that there needs to be a protocol in place that is transparent, that is negotiated upfront, and that can be triggered and effectively implemented when and if needed in a shock.
Thank you very much, Timothy. Let's go back to the audience. We got another email coming up, which we'll share with you and ask you gentlemen to respond. The US dollar is really on its final leg, according to this writer, and the Fed seems to have run out of options. To what extent will its collapse, that is, impact Barbados? Is that really so, Governor Haynes? Can I repeat the question?
I got a question.
Okay, fine.
I think what is critical at this point in time is really going to be related to our trade flows. Yes, the US currency may suffer periods of depreciation, but I think at the end of the day, what one will notice is that the US financial market is really a very strong financial market. And that, you know, I think we're going through a little bumpy period now in the US because of their trade tensions, etc. I think those will be resolved over time, and the US will resume its general dominance within the financial landscape. Clearly, you have other countries which are becoming more and more important, particularly the Chinas of this world. But I don't think that the how the US economy is going to go is going to lead to a general collapse of the dollar that will create a significant adverse impact on the Barbados economy.
Right. So that's the Barbados viewpoint. I wanted to ask the governor. Oh, we've got another question here. All right, let's go to the email again and see what this question is about. What are the central banks doing to allow countries to benefit from low oil prices? Except Guyana, of course. I'm not sure. But anyhow, let's ask the Guyana governor about this. Dr. Singh?
It's not Dr. Singh. I think you have another person here. Anyhow. Bottom line, look. Low oil prices would be beneficial to oil importing countries such as Guyana. We are now oil exporting also in terms of crude oil. But the impact from the lower oil price in terms of our profit from profit oil, that is, we would have received for every three shipment, we would have received one shipment in terms of receipts. Now, what we would have seen, we received one at $55 per barrel and then the other at about $35 per barrel. So you can see about a $20 difference. Now, that is much more than the benefit we would have received from the oil import. But the bottom line is that countries need to take advantage of low oil prices. Maybe they can buy forward. We are still dependent on fossil fuel to a large extent. Over time, I mean, we would like to see oil prices at some moderate level, being an oil exporting countries. But at the same time, it is important in terms of environmental protection and in terms of sustainable development that countries need to also diversify their energy needs. We have been doing that because we know that fossil fuel do have a finite amount. And therefore, from our end, we will try to maximize our revenues from oil. But at the same time, we will try to maximize our benefit from appropriate energy sources that are sustainable, that can provide positive for the environment, and also in terms of the welfare improvement of the people in Guyana, the region, and the world over.
Governor Byles, is it fair to say that Jamaica benefit from lower oil prices, or is this a situation in which the change in prices really don't affect or come into effect in our particular countries because of the arrangements that we do have?
No, oil prices are very important to us because we are a significant oil importing country. But over the years, we have managed to diversify away from heavy fuel oil. We have a significant part of our electricity program now being fueled by LNG. And we, of course, have a fairly substantial renewable sector in the energy business. Last year, we paid somewhere around $55 to $60 a barrel for oil. And so far this year, it's been 40 or a little less sometimes. And at that range, we can live with it. If it gets above that, then of course it becomes a challenge to us. So we looked at the possibility of doing either a forward or taking options on oil. And what I can say is this, that the oil market as a commodity market is very sophisticated, and nobody is sleeping at night. Everybody is up looking for opportunities to make a buck. And when oil prices falls, believe you me, there are lots of people who are there right at the moment getting ready to jump in, and before you know what happened, the prices are up back again. So it's not a market for amateurs to play around in. Jamaica has taken a position in, I think it was an option, and we didn't do very well with that. It's a bet that you take, and you can lose that bet. And when you lose that bet, it costs you a fair amount of US dollars. So not a market to play around with. I think it's best that you approach a problem in a more medium-term, long-term way by looking at diversifying the source of energy rather than playing in that commodity market.
Governor Antoine, you're in an environment where you're dealing with the situation of several countries all at the same time. What's the environment that you're working with in terms of decision making regarding oil prices?
So that's one of the positives of this pandemic. Oil prices have fallen, and as oil importing countries, that benefits us. Last year, we spent $1.5 billion on oil imports. This year, we will spend significantly less because of lower prices. That also helps us with our foreign exchange or foreign reserves, because as the old adage goes, $1 saved is a dollar earned. So that is working out well for us. But I agree with Governor Byles. For us, the focus now has to be on increasing renewables in our energy mix. In the ECCU, for example, only just under 10% of our electricity is generated from renewables, hydro and solar PV. We would love to see us triple that over the next 5 to 10 years. And we believe that that is important, not just to lower our carbon footprint from the environmental perspective, which of course is extremely important in the context of the climate crisis, which is an existential threat to our region, all of us, but also in terms of lowering the cost of doing business. This evening, we're talking about, you know, saving businesses. How do we protect businesses and jobs? We believe that lowering of those costs, energy costs, is a very important objective for helping our businesses to stay alive. Okay. And to be able to.
Thank you very much, sir. We're going to go to a quick break here and come back with more of the Caribbean Economic Forum.
Hi, my name is Shayana Kamirs, and I came to the Central Bank as an intern in 2018. After my internship, I was asked to continue my duties no longer as an intern, but now as a clerical officer. However, majority of my time has been spent at the Frank Colma Hall, commonly referred to as FCH, which is Barbados' premier performing arts center. During my time working at the FCH, I've had the opportunity of working alongside well-known and new and upcoming artists. I've also had the pleasure of working in the fields such as stage management, events management, lighting, sound, and overall general maintenance of the facility. Some of the most notable shows that I would have worked would be Mosaic, Operation Triple Threat, Youth Pan Project, NIFCA, and most notable, City Nights, which was first held in 1986 in celebration of the opening of the FCH and the new headquarters of the Central Bank of Barbados. Needless to say, the bank plays a pivotal role not only in the financial and economic governance of the island. There's a lot of behind the scenes work that takes place that unfortunately the public doesn't get to see. I can only hope that through our team's work, we get to share more about the numerous activities in which the organization is involved and showcase how it contributes to Barbados, both with its economic work and its support for the arts.
CEF is for me and you. Beyond COVID, CEF is for me and you. Caribbean Economic Forum, who? Beyond COVID, CEF is for me and you. Caribbean Economic Forum. Log on, tune in, and join the conversations, and engage with the experts, help to find common solutions.
www.centralbank.org.bb for more information.
And welcome back to the Caribbean Economic Forum, the 2020 series beginning this month and continuing right through to the end of the year, hosted by the Central Bank of Barbados. And we've got four governors with us this evening, not only the Cleviston Haynes, who is the governor of the Central Bank of Barbados, but also Richard Byles, the governor of the Bank of Jamaica in Kingston, Jamaica, where I am, Dr. Timothy Antoine, the governor of the Eastern Caribbean Central Bank in Bastion Kitts, and Dr. Gobind Ganga, governor of the Bank of Guyana. And I have to tell you, Dr. Ganga, why I said Singh. I've been in Trinidad too long. And every time I see the name Ganga, I think of Ganga Singh. So that's the history of that one. All right. Let's go to another member of our audience, and this time we're going to somebody in the United States. Roshane has provided us with a question, so let's hear from you. How are you doing? Welcome.
I'm doing good. How are you doing? Good evening, everybody.
Go right ahead with your question.
All right, so this question is for, I guess, the entire panel. Given that what we're dealing with coronavirus right now, and we're looking at in 2 months we'll be in the height of the hurricane season, how are we factoring the plans that we've made for coronavirus? How are we factoring the potential effects of the hurricane season on these small island states?
All right, that's a good question and very timely, since we, as he said, we're right in the hurricane season. Let's see. Cleviston Haynes, you want to take that since you're furthest in the Eastern Caribbean and most likely to feel the first winds?
Yes, we feel the first winds. But know, the issue of hurricanes is something that concerns us at all times, because as you would appreciate, the hurricanes seem to be getting stronger and stronger each year, and what they've been doing is very significant damage. You only have to recall what happened to Dominica about three years ago. So a lot of the sort of economic strategizing that we have done in recent years is related to preparing for the hurricanes. And Governor Antoine mentioned the fact that as part of our debt restructuring, we incorporated the hurricane clauses into our bonds, such that if there is a significant event for us, that we'll be able to sort of suspend payments on our both our external and our domestic debt for a period of 2 years. And that will provide for us significant fiscal savings to allow us to be able to rebuild our economy. Because as you would appreciate, the damage that these very strong systems can do to your economy will then put you under pressure as you try to rebuild that economy to get the funds necessary. It's very difficult these days. You get lots of commitments the time when an event occurs, but what you really want is to have those funds available so that you can repair your infrastructure and rebuild lives which are badly affected by these climatic events. So we are very conscious of that, and that is why you would see that we have incorporated the hurricane clauses into our debt restructuring.
All right, let me ask Governor Byles to respond on that question. I know that you're old enough to remember Hurricane Gilbert, and you really wouldn't want to have anything like that happen again to Jamaica or any other territory for that matter. But let's talk about it from your perspective.
Well, I think we're a lot more prepared today than we were for Gilbert. But nonetheless, Cleviston is right. The hurricanes are stronger than ever. And apart from trying to be lucky and dodge them, our usual hurricane preparedness has been put in place. But it would be a serious blow if on top of the pandemic, on top of the reversal in our tourism fortunes, that we were to feel a serious hurricane impact. So we do the best we can with our preparation, and just hope that we don't get a very serious full hit from one of these storms.
All right. Quickly, I will go to Governor Antoine in Bastère, because we're at a point where, 3 years now on from the serious impact of the Hurricane Maria on Dominica and the Leeward Islands, Anguilla, and so on. Let's hear your particular perspective on this matter, the question raised.
We are very, very mindful of the hurricane season, which is projected to be above average. So the truth is that we got a jump start in preparation because of the COVID-19 pandemic. So a lot of the work in terms of business continuity and resilience plans by our banks or licensees, by us as a central bank, and by our people in general, we've sort of focused in early on the things that we need to do. So we're praying, we're planning, and we're praying. That's our strategy. And our hope is that we will be able to weather that particular storm. God knows we could do without one of those right now.
Let's go now to another question from our audience. This is Delano, who's got a question for the panel. Welcome, Delano.
Good evening to the governors and all of the viewership and listenership. I want to thank the governors for giving up their time to sit with the region and have this candid conversation about COVID-19 and the future. Now, I have two questions. The first is for Governor Antoine. Governor Antoine, given that some countries in the ECCU have had to amend their national insurance fund policy to in order to allow for the payment of unemployment benefits during this time of COVID-19, is this something that you believe that going forward, much like Barbados and other countries in the region, should these ECCU countries now consider making unemployment benefits a permanent feature of their policy? And in addition to that, what would that mean for the sustainability and the solvency of these national insurance funds? Now, the second question I have is for all of the governors, really. Is it time in the region for our governments to rethink our current regime of travel tax in terms of interregional taxes? And what role, if any, do you guys see the central banks playing in this process. Thank you and have a good evening.
Thank you very much, Solano. So, Governor Antoine?
So, yes, we believe that the time is ripe for us to look at unemployment insurance, unemployment benefit for our social security systems. The reality is that our social security systems are the single most important safety net, social safety net that we have in this region. And the reality is that in the last few years, they have been called upon too often, far too often to our liking, to deal with situations. So whether it is Irma or Maria in 2017, or it's the pandemic now, these social security systems are being called upon to perform. And there is no provision, as is the case in Barbados, as you pointed out, for unemployment benefits. So I have already suggested that once we get past this period, we do have to look seriously at including an unemployment benefit in our social security systems to ensure their viability long-term. Very quickly, on the second question, I think we do have to have that conversation. We know for a fact that 50%, just about 50% of our airfares, what we call TFCs, tax fees and charges, TFCs, and we need to have that conversation. But that's a regional conversation with our governments, because no single government could unilaterally change that and make any difference. If one country did it now, all that would happen is that they would lose revenue and there'll be no increase in traffic. So our governments would need to come together to discuss this issue and agree on a reduction to incentivize regional travel, especially in this period of downturn. So that's a regional conversation.
All right, and that regional conversation may have an impact on the discussions that are due to be held on Saturday, where the shareholders of LIAT are getting together to talk about the current situation. All right, let's go to another member of the audience, and Oshana is online with a question for the panel. Oshana, welcome.
Hi, everybody. I guess my question is to Governor Byles. I heard you in your introduction, you touched briefly on the Jamaican Stock Exchange. So my question is, how big a role do you think the GSE has in Jamaica's recovery post-COVID?
All right, thank you, sir.
Yeah, so I had mentioned before that the stock exchange took a pretty big hit with the closure of our borders. And, you know, it took a big hit because it was a star performer. It means that a lot of people were invested in it, particularly a whole host of new, younger investors got interested in the market. Maybe you are one of them. And so it was very disappointing to see that the market had to take that step back. The market does have a very important role to play in Jamaica's development, and it has. I mean, over the years, I would say over the last maybe 6-8 years, a lot, many companies have come to the market through the stock exchange, and they have done very well. They've raised billions of dollars of capital. So there's no question that the stock exchange has a major role to play in our future development. It depends a lot on getting the economy as a whole back on track. And that is what our aim is, to make sure that the foundation on which recovery that is long-lasting, that foundation is solid. And that needs us to be very prudent in our macro-fiscal management.
Let's turn our attention again to the audience, taking advantage of this historic conversation with central bank governors across the region. Here's an email with a question. Have we erred and imposed on Social Security funds to relieve a crisis resulting from nationally declared emergencies, rather than use wartime methods of financing to provide basic incomes as subsistence allowances? All right, let me see if I can direct this to the Governor Ganga in Georgetown.
Yes, Julie. When we are speaking about the livelihood of people, it doesn't matter where we are looking, if it is from a Social Security fund or some emergency fund with respect to some wartime, whatever. The bottom line is that we have to look at the livelihood of people. In this region, we still have a high level of poverty. When we talk about monetary, fiscal, and other type of policies, that doesn't make any sense to the people, the poor people, and those who are vulnerable. So we have to have certain measures in place to ensure that there is sustainable relief in terms of welfare for these people. Meaning, we should have the basic social security guarantee in terms of an income to the vulnerable, to those in the informal sectors that are most affected with any situation, not just COVID, but it's an ongoing thing that we have to be very, very cognizant of. So while we can use all the fancy terms in terms of an accommodative monetary policy, a fiscal stance that would allow more government spending, we have to ensure that we have focused policies to ensure the minimum in terms of for people's livelihood, meaning they should have the basic needs. So we have to have an approach, which is, as I said earlier, one that would encourage for the sustainability of the, I would say here, the sustainable development goal. That is so important for us in this region, because those in the informal sector are almost 30 to 40%. And when you look and you see the kind of poverty that exists, you have to really think hard in terms of what kind of social security system you put in place or welfare program. But the welfare program we put should be one which will allow for some diversification economy and to ensure that these people have productive and decent jobs so they can also contribute towards the growth and development of the of their economy and the region as a whole. Here we are talking about not only building resilience within the family, but building resilience that will also help for the national economy development, which obviously will spill over to regional development. Thank you, Julian.
Thank you very much, sir, and thanks for your patience getting us back on track here. This is the Caribbean Economic Forum, and we are going to continue our session with Tony, another member of the audience joining us. Tony, welcome. Welcome, Tony. Oh, he just dropped out. Okay, fine. We'll be, hopefully you'll get back in and be able to join us. I want to stay with the question last posed and give Governor Haynes an opportunity to respond to that. I know you did talk about the importance of looking after the vulnerable in terms of all the measures and planning, et cetera. So here's a chance to expand for the benefit of the audience.
Yes, thanks, Julian. The issue here really is twofold. It's very important for us to have a social safety net in order to protect persons maybe encounter these things of difficult situations. But fundamentally, the issue comes back to the strength of our overall macroeconomic policies, which allows us to build buffers, give us the resilience that we need in these situations. Because ultimately, our capacity to be able to fund, whether through a social safety net or through economic transfers, is going to depend quite heavily on what fiscal space we have at that point in time. And sometimes what happens is that because we've run large deficits for a prolonged period, we don't have the resources available to be able to finance either the social safety net or the increased welfare that we need when we meet a challenge like this. So I think what this COVID situation has taught us is that we need to build buffers such that we are able to be resilient if impacted by these types of events.
This is the Caribbean Economic Forum with his historic gathering of governors of the central banks of the region. Timothy Antoine at the headquarters of the Eastern Caribbean Currency Union in Bastos and Kitts, Dr. Gobind Ganga at the Bank of Guyana in Georgetown, Richard Byles at the Bank of Jamaica in Kingston, where I am, and Cleviston Haynes, the last governor you just heard from, at the bank's headquarters in Bridgetown, Barbados. And it is the Central Bank of Barbados that is playing host in this series, which is monthly, and will give you an opportunity to talk to several personalities across the region to focus on particularly the whole matter of recovery from the COVID-19 pandemic, which has so affected much of this region. And of course, we've encouraged you all to get involved and to send us your questions, etc. And in fact, we know we have a new question to pose to our panel. Let's see what that question is. What role can digitizing public sector regulatory agencies play in helping to modernize and diversify our markets beyond tourism sector initiatives to make our regional export markets more competitive? I know this is a pet subject for Governor Ganga in terms of technology and its impact on our region. So I'm going to give you a chance to deal with this one first.
Look, Julian, indeed, look, enhancing our technology and digitalizing transactions, they are very important to improve efficiency so that we can have increased production productivity within our economy. But we have to be cognizant of the fact that we do have different age group. We have different people from the perspective of those who are computer literate, who are not. So we have to be very, very careful in terms of the phasing of technology, not only within our productive system, but also within our social contacts. Indeed, there is so much to be had from the digitalized transaction. But once again, we also have to be very careful with respect to fraud. We will find that those who have gone straight into, for example, having more digitalized payment would have encountered quite a lot of fraud. So we have to be careful so that we have this safety in terms of cybersecurity. We have to have the kind of I would say, capabilities to overlook employees who are part and parcel of this digitalized world because of fraud. So yes, more technology will enhance production and productivity. We don't want to have people who will be left back. We have to bring them up. We have to train them. We have to improve their capabilities. We have to ensure that we have proper system to ensure that we don't encounter fraud. And at the same time, we have to be cognizant that we don't take away what this COVID has shown us. Although we have this virtual meeting, I missed having my fellow governors near to me for a hug, for a shake hand, and whatever. So we have to be very careful what we are attempting to do here. Thank you, Julian.
All right. Hopefully that situation will change in time. Governor Byles, I want to bring you in here because I live here, I'm aware of the deployment of technology in the service of people, whether it's from the public sector or from the private sector, for instance. Is it that COVID has really forced on us the greater use of technology?
Absolutely. And maybe that is the one good thing that COVID has brought to us. So issues of working from home, I think, is an exciting new way to balance work life and private life and to be still very productive. And even at our institution, we are experimenting with it, and so far we have found it to be excellent. But the whole business of government interfacing with the public, how you apply for licenses, how you pay taxes, pay fees, whatever the service that government has to provide, to be able to do that online, to do it without having to get up from where you are and go somewhere else, enhances efficiency tremendously. And I don't think we could, anyone could argue against that. The electronic payments too, vital. I mean, it's so efficient. And yes, I agree with Gobind that there is added opportunity for fraud, but you have to protect against it. It's just vastly more efficient than the old way of doing stuff. Could I take a minute and talk a bit about the remittance business, which has kind of transferred from the old form of going to the bank and getting the cash to doing so electronically. And we've seen a lot of that in Jamaica. And to the credit of the remittance business, even in this pandemic period, it has stood up strongly. And indeed, we haven't seen a reduction in remittances to Jamaica. We have seen a small increase. And I would say that that is has to do a bit with the technology that is being used now to be able to transfer money so much more easily rather than physically going to a destination to pick it up. So here again is a real life example of how technology can positively impact ourselves.
Thank you very much, Governor Byles. I know that one of the elements that that I'm sure Cleviston Haynes had wanted to talk about, because we'd had a conversation before, is the matter of the automatic clearinghouse, which certainly would speed up the communication between, say, the central bank and the various banks across the markets there in Barbados. Governor Haynes?
Yes, Julian. The whole issue of payments, as my colleagues mentioned, is very important for us as we go forward. It's going to be critical as we move away from traditional use of cash, use of checks, to be able to have electronic payments. And what we see in Barbados is that we are trying to modernize our ACH to have new players in the market come on stream to be able to deliver financial services, because financial services represent a critical element of how we can improve efficiency within the economy. As Governor Byles just said, for too long we've had systems that were somewhat archaic. We have to go stand in line to make payments. This loses time, efficiency, productivity. And therefore, if we can use the payment system to be able to reduce the amount of time that persons spend standing in lines to make payments, then I think we are going to be able to enhance productivity and ultimately to enhance our competitiveness as we go forward. One of the critiques of the Barbados economy in recent years has been doing business, that we're not set up really to do business efficiently. And I think that the whole question of the payment system is going to be a critical part of how we enhance our ability to do business in a modern world.
I think the matter of technology does open up a discussion as well about blockchain. And I want to toss this to Governor Antoine in Basse-Terre. Are you operating a blockchain environment in a sandbox and testing the systems? What's the situation there?
So thanks, Julian. There is no investment that can make this region internationally competitive that is more compelling than digital transformation. And so my colleagues have spoken to the issue of payments. And what we see, if you look at the global economy, it is going digital. By 2025, at least half of the global economy will be digitized. So if we're going to have any fighting chance of survival, we have to innovate. As I put it, our survival must be the driver of innovation. So at the ECCB, what we've done is to, as part of advancing that process of digitizing our economies and societies, is to move forward with a project to digitize the EC dollar. And we will use blockchain to do that. We are at an advanced stage now of preparing to launch, and we expect to launch that not in a few weeks' time. The reality is that payments are too slow, they are too expensive, as has been said, and we believe that we could do better. And we need to be secure. And that's where we believe the central bank has a role to play. And interestingly enough, there are at least 70 central banks now actively working on digital currency pilots or projects. I know Bahamas has also moved forward with that, and we will keep you informed as we go along.
All right. Well, would believe how much time has gone so far, and just enough time for me to do a round robin, so to speak, of the governors. I want all of you to give a message to the audience across this Caribbean and beyond our region, for that matter. Is there a message of hope that you can give to people who are looking at the back end of this pandemic, etc., and are desperately hoping that they would see some improvement. And based on your own knowledge and your own projections, et cetera, what's the parting shot you can give to people here? Let me start with Richard Byles in Kingston, Jamaica.
Yes, thank you. You know, Jamaica has gone through in the last 45 years at least two other critical economic recessions. In 1970, 75, 76, with the oil price that shot through the roof, it took us nearly 14 years to get back to that level of GDP. So up to 1989, we had just achieved what we had done in 1975. And then again in 2007-08, with the financial crisis emanating in the US, it took us nearly 11 years to 2018 before we got back to the 2007 level. So those kind of U-shaped recessions are very difficult for the people of the Caribbean and for Jamaica. Because we entered this situation much stronger in terms of our fiscal discipline, our exchange reserves, the strength of our banking system, we don't expect to have a U-shaped recovery, but more a kind of V-shaped recovery. So I expect that as soon as we can get the tourism business up and going again, we'll be back to where we were last year.
Thank you very much, Governor Byles. I'm forcing all the other governors to be very, very tight. Let's go to Dr. Ganga in Georgetown. You got about 30 seconds, if not less.
Julian, thanks. Look, lots of hope. We are each other's keeper. We have a regional brotherhood. We are all Caribbean people. We have resilience. We know how to address our challenges. All that we have to stick close to each other. Indeed, individually, nationally, we will look inward, but inward will also provide us with that impetus so we can all share in terms of this spillover effect positively to the rest of the region. This is going to
thank you.
This is
thank you very much, sir. Thank you. I have to take it right there because I'm being told by my producer that my time is running out. I have just enough time in which to thank you, governors, for joining us in this historic panel and discussion across the region, and to our audience wherever you are as well. Let me invite you to come to the next production, which is July the 28th, when we look at the tourism sector. Again, thank you very much. And let's go now with a very special celebration by the entertainers of the Caribbean.
Always bring us together. Love will always see us through. This is who we are.